Do you want to grow more food? Don't make the same mistakes that I've made. Are you afraid of killing your plants? Well, my book has already created hundreds of other successful growers, and I've even made over 7 figures growing this ancient vegetable. It's a staple food crop for millions of people and a pioneer plant for new and establishing farms all over the world. Growing this plant has even saved my farm and many other farms from bankruptcy. There's no other book like this in the world. It includes membership into my agriculture collective with 24/7 support and a network of other like-minded growers. You could spend the next 10 years learning how to grow more food yourself, or just let me guide you. Jack and Barry are already making a living from products that they make at the farmers market and on their own websites. Ask them yourself inside the members area. Like this video if you haven't yet, share it with all your garden groups, click the link below to get the full manual. Now, watch and listen to chapter 1 of Grow Moringa, the Ultimate Guide. Peace, love, and prosperous growing. I'll see you inside the members area.
Pathogenic microorganism growth or toxin formation is not acceptable. Garlic and oil mixtures that are not modified in a way so that they are unable to support pathogenic microorganism growth or toxin formation are not acceptable. What types of cottage foods can you produce? Loaf breads, rolls and biscuits, cakes, pastries and cookies, candies, confections, and honey. Jams, jellies and preserves made from high acid fruits only. Fruit pies and dried fruits. Dry herbs, seasonings and mixtures. Homemade pasta, cereals, trail mixes and granola. Coated or uncoated nuts. Vinegar and flavored vinegars. Popcorn and popcorn balls. Nut butters including almond, peanut, cashew, etc. What types of food are cottage food prohibited? Salsa, barbecue sauces, ketchups and or mustards, canned fruits and vegetables, chutneys, vegetable butters and jellies, flavored oils, hummus, garlic dip and salsa, fish or shellfish products, canned pickled products such as corn relish, pickles, sauerkraut, raw seeds and sprouts, bakery goods which require any type of refrigeration such as cream, custard or meringue pies and cakes or pastries with cream cheese icings or fillings, eggs, milk, dairy products including hard, soft and cottage cheeses and yogurt, cut fresh fruits and or veggies, juices made from fresh fruits or veggies, iced and or ice products, fresh or dried meat or meat products including jerky, focaccia-style breads with vegetables and or cheeses, homemade icings and frostings made from dairy-based cream cheese and or butter, any products containing hemp, hemp extract or CBD derived from the cannabis plant. Labels. The cottage food law requires specific labeling requirements for the sale of cottage food products. A cottage food operation may only sell cottage food products which are prepackaged with a label affix that contains the following information. Include the name and address of the cottage food operation. Include the name of the cottage food product. Include the ingredients of the cottage food product in descending order of predominance by weight. Include the net weight or net volume of the cottage food product. Include allergen information as specified by federal labeling requirements. If any nutritional claim is made, include appropriate nutritional information as specified by federal labeling requirements. Include the following statement printed in at least 10-point type in a color that provides a clear contrast to the background label. Made in a cottage food operation that is not subject to Florida's food safety regulations. What does allergen labeling, as specified in federal labeling requirements, mean? It means you must identify any of your ingredients if they are made from one of the following food groups: milk, eggs, wheat, peanuts, soybeans, fish, and tree nuts. Moringa powder can be added to any of the following products and be sold at a farmer's market with cottage rule labeling, as moringa cookies, moringa jam, or moringa cake. If you have an ingredient made with a wheat-based product, you can include the allergen in the ingredient list. For example, white bread with the following ingredient listing: whole wheat flour, water, salt, and yeast. In this example, the statement whole wheat flour meets the requirements of federal law. After the ingredient list, include an allergen statement. Contains ingredients contained in the product. For example, a white bread with the following ingredients: whole wheat flour, water, sodium caseinate, salt, and yeast. This allergen warning should be written as contains wheat and milk. The contains statement must reflect all the allergens found in the product. In this example, sodium caseinate comes from milk. Are there any special requirements for tree nuts labeling for allergens? Yes, if your cottage food has tree nuts as an ingredient, you must identify which tree nut you are using. For example, if you made nut bread, an acceptable ingredient list would be ingredients: wheat flour, water, almonds, salt, yeast. The following would not be acceptable: ingredients, flour, water, nuts, salt, yeast. Am I required to send products to a laboratory to obtain an official ingredient list, or is it something I can put together on my own? You are not required to have your product analyzed by a laboratory to obtain an official ingredient list. If you use a prepared item in your recipe, you must list sub-ingredients as well. For example, only listing soy sauce is not acceptable. You would need to list soy sauce, wheat, soybeans, and salt on your label. Allergen labeling, as specified in federal labeling requirements, must also be included. I am concerned that some of my product ingredients that are not allergens are trade secrets. Therefore, listing all my ingredients would lead to unfair competition. Do I have to list all my ingredients, or can I protect my trade secrets? According to federal regulations, Food and Drug Administration, FDA, 21 CFR 101.100 grams 1-2, exceptions to labeling can be made. If the Commissioner of Food and Drugs finds that alleged secret ingredients are harmless, an exemption may be granted. You should contact the FDA to discuss and propose an exemption from labeling. Do I have to include my home address on my product labeling, or is a post office box sufficient? You must use the physical address of your home kitchen on your product label, not a post office box. The purpose of including an address on product labels is in case of a recall or trace back associated with a foodborne illness complaint or outbreak. If I make and sell wedding or other specialty cakes, how can I meet the labeling requirements when I can't stick a label on the cake? For cakes that are not easily packaged, you must include all labeling requirements on the invoice and deliver the invoice with the cake. If boxed, the label must be included on the box. Chapter 1.7, Laws and Regulations. Florida laws and regulations for the moringa tree industry. Several laws directly affect or regulate the moringa tree industry and other nursery and agriculture businesses. Adherence to these laws is not only the responsibility of management, but in many cases, of every person involved. The following does not include all of the laws and regulations, nor does it go into great detail. The purpose is to ensure that moringa businesses are aware of the laws they are most likely going to encounter. The Plant Inspection Law, Florida Statutes 581.141 and 581.211, Florida Administrative Code 5B. The purpose of this law is the protection of agricultural interests of the state of Florida. Most nursery operators consider this a beneficial law in multiple ways. It helps to protect their product, and it helps them to detect and apply control measures before plant pest problems become serious. The law requires everyone who grows, buys and sells or distributes plants to register with the Division of Plant Industry of the Florida Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services. For the purpose of the law, only those who grow are considered nurseries. Nurseries pay an annual fee for inspection based on their inventory of plants with a minimum of $25 to a maximum of $460. The same fee structure applies to stock dealers, brokers and agents. Specialists from the division regularly inspect nursery stock in nurseries. They conduct continuing surveys for all types of agricultural plant pests and periodically inspect nursery stock in dealers' locations. These specialists also provide inspections for out-of-state shipments, out-of-country shipments when special certification is required, and for a number of other special purposes. Special fees apply to these inspections. A valid inspection tag issued by the DPI is required when plants are sold wholesale, for shipment out-of-state, and for shipment by a common carrier. Special tags are required on the sale of citrus plants. The plant inspection law provides for quarantine of plants when serious plant pests are found. Additional measures, which under certain situations may include destruction of nursery stock, may be required for emergency plant pest problems. Detailed information is available from the Division of Plant Industry, Florida Department of Agriculture, PO Box 147,100, Danesville, FL 32614. Preservation of Native Flora, Florida Statutes 581.185, Florida Administrative Code 5B40. This section of law provides for the protection of a great number of native plants by prohibiting or restricting their harvest, collection, or removal. Licensed certified nursery growers, however, are allowed to sell commercially grown plants of protected species. Any nursery or person contemplating buying, selling, digging, or transporting plants from their natural habitat should be aware of the provisions of this law. Additional information is available from the Division of Plant Industry. Florida Viability Law, Florida Statutes 581.142, Florida Administrative Code 5B. The intent of the viability law is to prevent the sale of nursery stock that is not living or that is so deteriorated that it is not capable of living. Basic requirements are that at the time of sale, nursery stock must be free of defects that would prevent the essential parts from functioning normally, have a functional root system or the ability to grow one, have trunks and branches capable of transporting fluids, have leaves capable of performing essential functions, or free of leaves, must have the ability to produce new leaves. The law further requires protection of nursery stock when on display at sales outlets and spells out minimum requirements of viability. Additional information can be obtained from the DPI at the address listed above. Sales and Use Tax Law, Florida Statutes 212.06. The information presented here is a limited and an approximate summary of the regulations. It should not be applied to actual tax situations. This law requires the collection of a sales tax by those persons or concerns engaged in the sale or rental of products or commodities. As a rule, if you sell a product and you cannot prove the transaction was exempt from sales tax, you are responsible for payment of the tax. Unless a seller receives from the purchaser a resale certificate or an exemption certificate which states the property was purchased from resale or some exempt purpose, sales tax is required to be collected. This certificate must be received by the seller prior to or at the time of sale. Businesses providing certain services, as well as products, are governed by varying sales tax requirements depending on the nature of the contract or agreement. A summary of certain types of situations is included below. Retailer, sales tax is to be collected at the time of sale, except when a certificate of exemption applies. Wholesaler, all sales of nursery stock are presumed to be retail sales and must have sales tax added unless the buyer presents to the seller a resale certificate or an exemption certificate. Out-of-state sales may be exempt depending on the specific situation. Sellers need to be aware of provisions on out-of-state sales. Landscape contractor, a landscape contractor who uses a lump sum, cost, plus fixed fee or guaranteed price contract does not have to collect sales tax if he/she pays tax on items purchased to use on the job. If, however, the landscape contractor itemizes the materials and supplies, then sales tax is required from the customer, and the landscape contractor should use a resale exemption when buying plants and supplies under this premise. Landscape maintenance. A landscape maintenance contractor does not need to collect sales tax for maintenance only. Installation of plants would be governed by the rules for landscape contractors. Interior maintenance. Interior maintenance is governed by the same provisions as for landscape maintenance unless plant material is provided, in which case, see the following paragraph. Interiorscape installation. In lump sum interiorscape contracts, no tax is charged, however, taxes are charged in lease agreements. When interiorscape plants are installed and become a part of the real estate, the rules discussed under the landscape contractor section would be applicable. Brokers. A broker must charge tax unless the broker receives an exemption certificate or a resale certificate. Out-of-state sales. It depends on whether the sale is deemed as having taken place in Florida or outside of the state as to whether tax is charged. Details are included in state regulations. Purchase items by nursery operators. Many items purchased by nursery operators for use in their businesses are exempt. These include items that are incorporated into the finished plant materials. Specific rules should be checked for important details. Again, all laws, rules, and regulations should be carefully checked for specific details. The inclusion of the information here is simply to convey general information. Detailed sales tax information is available from the Department of Revenue at door.myfloridea.com/. Agricultural License and Bond Law, Florida Statutes 604.19 and 604.20 and Florida Administrative Code 5A1. The Florida License and Bond Law was enacted in 1941 to give market protection to producers of perishable agricultural commodities. Because the product the Florida grower is selling is perishable and indistinguishable from other like products once removed from the shipping container, the producer is at the mercy of the receiver for payment. There is no opportunity to simply return the product. Without the administrative process offered by the law, Florida growers would be faced with lengthy and expensive civil suits. In most cases, the cost recovery would be greater than the value of the product. The law is specifically designed for the protection of the grower and includes all sod, hay, and horticulture. License and bond requirement. This law requires dealers in agricultural products, example landscape contractors, plant brokers, or nursery stock dealers. They need to be licensed with Florida Department of Agriculture's Bureau of Agriculture dealers licenses if they buy directly.